picture. So anyway,
So we have not started, right?
this is a usual trick I play on my interviewees. Actually, we have just started, but but I normally wait for a moment or two before telling them.
Okay.
So I the title of today's talk, of today's discussion is when a photo speaks for more than 1,000 words, more than 1,000,000 words. 1,000 is the cliche, but I would say million. And displayed on the screen is this very, very dramatic picture dating back to 1982, 1981, Sandeep.
Yeah, similar time. Yeah, probably three plus decades. Sorry. Yeah,
Four decades.
four, almost 4. Yeah.
And with me is someone who I've admired since my college days, since I was in short pants, with a bit of exaggeration, not exactly short pants, long pants. And that person is Sandeep Naik.
Yeah. Thank you, Fred, having me. But to be honest, I would be more comfortable behind the a camera than rather being here. And I mean, you since you've asked me to speak on this, I'm here. Yeah, thank
You
you.
need not be self-effacing and you need not be modest and you can be totally
I
informal
am modest.
and be totally informal. I know you're a little bit nervous, but since I'm so used
They're
to jabbering, I'm not nervous. I think
good.
it's also important, Sanjeep, to get people like you to get your stories recorded and told, no? Because
Yeah,
this is history. This is
sure.
history. Okay, so let's start at the beginning. This is a story which influenced my perception of Sandeep Naik, and I've been tracking him. Kind of, hounding him. What is the right word in online space? Kind of hunting him for many years. Till I found him in the Gulf, and I introduced myself, and I said, "See, I joined journalism a bit after you did." And
Yeah, that's right.
Sandeep connected with me, and we've been sharing a lot of information and names and connects, and our paths crossed a lot, though we never worked in the same place together, never ever.
No.
Sandeep, without saying too much, tell us, this is your most famous photo as far as Goa is concerned. This is the most famous.
I'm till date surprised, Frederick, that people remember this picture very vividly, and then they say, "Are Sandeep, you took this picture?" I think this particular image is a classic story of being at the right time at the right place. And if you know our colleague Kamil Parke, and he and I were at Navin Times, and we were covering this agitation, and we came to know that there is going to be a little trouble. So we stationed ourselves in front of the secretariat, and out of nowhere, I think there was this lathi charge announced, and I happened to be just behind the guy who has raised his the
Lati, lati,
lathi, yeah. And it just happened in a fraction of a second, and these girls were poor thing. They were like caught between the devil and the deep sea,
literally
literally.
the sea, literally the sea. There's a river that side.
And I barely managed to get 2 frames. And those days you didn't have this digital thing to go back and check. So you always were thinking that, yeah, I hope I got the picture, but you were never sure till the time you saw it on your negative. And when I saw this, I knew that this is an image that, I mean, I was very lucky to score. And this picture not only got published in Navin Times, it got published in Indian Express. At that point of time, Times of India was on the strike. So Indian Express and the Marathi paper called Lok Satta,
Lok Satta.
they displayed this on their front page. And you'll be surprised the really one comment that I remember about this image was, it came from Mr. Falero, who was MP at that time,
Edward Fellow.
and he, Edward Falero, and he said that he used to sit next to Falero, FG in that order, and he said that Mr. Rajiv Gandhi came flashing the newspaper and said, "Mr. Falero, I thought Goans were very decent folks, and this is what you do to your." He says, "Sandeep, I was very embarrassed, but at the same time, I really admired your photo." And I think that was something nice about him then.
So to fill in my perspective on this photo, this was during our student days when there were a lot of student agitations in the late 70s, early 80s. And I think this was anti-Voditala capitation college or Baspe hike or one of those protests.
Correct.
And what is so dramatic, this is a black and white photo. Of course, all photos are black and white in those times. The police are just, you got it at that point where the police has raised the lathi to the peak and the girls are obviously scared and cowering, and they are simple, you know, average girl students who, you know, may have got caught in the middle or they may have been protesting, we don't know. But like, you know, they are frightened by what will happen next. And Navin Times carried the next day in four columns, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, that's right.
Columns on top of page one. It goes to Indian Express, where they carry it in four columns on top of the page on page one.
True.
Then it became a symbol of protest in Goa. If I'm not mistaken, Professor Sergio Carvalho printed postcards of this photo. I don't know if you've seen it. I think you told me you didn't see it. I've got it somewhere.
Yeah, somebody told me even Matani Saldana printed that on.
Sergio Carvalho.
Sergio Carvalho. Okay.
Yeah, Professor of Education.
Okay,
College.
Okay.
So it's a fascinating photo. I think Kamil Parke has written an article about, on this incident, and he talks about how he met you and you were not sure whether the photo has come out or not.
Yes.
You knew it would work, but there were no digital cameras. You can't see what it's shooting. Okay.
Exactly.
It's shooting in the dark. And then you developed it at our friend Olencio's Hollywood.
Olencio, and that was like the hub of all the photographers who used to come there. And that time, as you know, there were only Navin Times, and there was Herald, and you know, Rashtramat, and very few.
Gomantak,
Ambaji Kamat, Sunil Naik, me, Minino, Louis.
Minino Afons.
Louis.
Louis Godino.
Louis Godino, who then went abroad, I guess. Yes. And they were, and funny enough, everyone ended up at Hollywood. And Hollywood is, Olencio's mother is very instrumental in helping me and, you know, taking forward my career. She was very encouraging and always gave a, you know, I mean, they helped us not only in terms of photography, but personally, she was such a wonderful person. Even Olencio is a very, very nice individual.
So we are talking of Goa in the 1980s, where everything is done in the darkroom. And photography is just coming to age because we are moving out from the letterpress, hot metal style of printing, and we are moving into offset. And I don't know if it had happened already, but it was just happening then. And Hollywood studio. Hollywood. And in those days, photos used to come just as blotches, black blotches, and suddenly things improved.
Correct.
But Hollywood was a small studio in a National Square, where all of us who like photography in one way or the other kind of ganged up there. I was on the periphery. I'm not claiming to be any great photographer. It was always my desire to learn, but I never learned darkroom techniques and all that. So this is the history you're telling us. And Olencio's mother, the late Mrs. Palmira Coutinho.
Coutinho.
Yeah. Was,
you know something? She appeared on the cover of David Bailey's photography book.
That's Munang Sotalong.
That's a remarkable
David
thing.
Bailey is this great British photographer, and she appeared on the cover of his book as a lady photographer from Asia or something like that.
Yeah. He's a phenomenal photographer, David Bailey.
Yeah. Don't worry, Marshall Light gale tayat
lepot. I'm just praying for the same year.
You take care of yours. I have backup, except that you'll see me as a ghost for a little while.
Yeah, we do. Yeah.
It'll come. If you join me late, we are with Sandeep Naik. And Sandeep has been one of Goa's prominent photographers of the 80s. And after that in the Gulf. We will talk about that later. But first to go to the 80s, because that is one period of history where we understand very little about and we are forgetting a lot about it. Sarkhe Mare. Tell us about your other photography colleagues. Then we'll go to your other media colleagues. But first your photography colleagues of those days.
Yeah. Oh, actually, when I went to Navin Times, I went to do illustrations because I graduated from Goa College of Art. Hello.
Don't worry. I'm there. I'm just putting the spotlight onto
Yeah.
you. So don't worry. You carry on, please. I'm there.
Okay.
I'm in the background.
Okay. I graduated from Goa College of Art and then went to do illustrations. And Vikram Vora, then the editor, encouraged me to take photos because I had done my majors in photography. And this is how I got into the field of photojournalism. At that point of time, sorry, that point of time, Sunil Naik was my senior. And Ambaji Kamath was in Gomantak. And Louis Godino was with Harold. And Minino was there. So we were only a few handful of photographers then. And so to speak, the whole photography was done in black and white. And as I said, the developing center was Harold, sorry, Olancios Hollywood,
Hollywood.
Olancios Hollywood. And that's where we all met. And it was a very nice kind of, we were all very friendly, even though there was a professional rivalry between us, but it didn't mean that, you know, we were very good friends to each other.
Sandeep, most memorable photos of that era, yours or others, in Goa?
Mine would be the one that I explained, the Lathi charge one. And I had a very brief time in Navin Times since 80 to 84. And then in 85, I was given opportunity to join Gulf News in Dubai by then editor Vikram Vora, who got a job as an editor in Gulf News. And he, along with me, took few of our colleagues there. Hello?
Sorry,
Fred?
I forgot I was off. Your old colleague from Navprabha, Gurudas Sawal, saying hi, Sandeep.
Hi.
So that's interesting. Thanks for telling us the names of the colleagues then. Now tell us about Bikram Vora. You all are all Bikram Vora's boys. I don't mean it in a pejorative sense, but he came to Goa. He, like you, was a bright star and went off quite fast. But he took a lot of talented Goan journalists. That's again not a complaint because many of you all had full careers in the Gulf. So tell us about your experiences with Bikram. And I remember him as a very kind of colorful editor. And the moment he came in Navin Times, everything changed.
He is one person you would love to work under because he's such a person who'll motivate you, encourage you, and you know, always say how you should go about it, what are good images, how you should make an. And he was one of the editors who was very image oriented. He would say, first thing, photo kidhar hai, bring me a photo. I want to see the photo. And he had a lot of emphasis on the visual aspects of the newspaper. And that is something that I guess encouraged all of us who worked with him. And when I went to Dubai, there was another colleague of mine called Aziz Shah, who also had was also from Goa and who helped me a lot. And then when we went to Dubai, then later my colleague, what's his name?
Ravi Shankar,
No, Ravi Shankar, Sudhakar Rao,
Alred Lewis,
Alred Lewis, Gabriel Sah,
Gabriel Sah.
and they were there. Then later than that, I guess we met Anthony from here, who had joined in Sharjah, the newspaper, and Willie, Glenn, Ellery
Willie
Combs,
Pereira, Wilfred Pereira, Glenn.
later they came. They came
Yeah, they
later
came later. They came later.
to Gulf.
अरे कौन एक तो हाय मुंटा मरे गालफांत ले
All right.
good to
see Alaric you. There. You talk of him and he's there.
Talk of the devil and the devil appears. Na Alaric the devil no. Barabar jata.
Alaric is a good friend.
Okay, so yeah. Sorry for the interruption, but this is part of the game.
Yeah.
So I Bikram was a very colorful guy. I remember it was a letterpress days, so changing a paper was not easy in those days. Being photographically oriented was not easy because you made blocks of photos and the blocks often printed as black smudges.
Correct.
But nonetheless, he did a
Willy,
lot.
Willy Goyce's dad was the master at it. I mean, he was one of our block maker, and those days he used to really work hard, you know, and create.
Willy Goyce's dad.
Yeah. Willy Goyce's dad.
So Willy, multi talented Willy, who is
correct.
Who is an artist, a musician, an author.
Yes.
Ani kider hai, and translator, ani singer, ani khub thing, many things.
Tazo Bapu. He's dead. I wouldn't recollect
his name.
Yeah, Goyce. We used to always address him as Mr. Goyce. For us, he was always Mr. Goyce.
Mr. Goyce or Uncle Munpa Chaitanya.
No, Mr. Goyce. He was always Mr. Goyce. Yeah.
Interesting. You know, but these aspects of our print history need to be captured. And that's why, Sandeep, I dragged you here and brought you here. Of course, we have time, so that's not an issue. And I think it's so important to keep these stories for another generation.
If you recollect those days, there was no photo agency or wire photos or something. So what Vikram Vora, I guess he was a pioneer in all this. He made me take photos from the television.
I see.
And, you know, stills, yeah. And the stills, like, and I think Kamil Parke wrote on that as well, about how we used to use these images. And when I went to Dubai, I was so surprised to see Wimbledon photo. It is finished and it was there on the desk. Even then, when I went in 85, 86, we used to get black and white. Then the color printing with the Gulf News started. And then we used to have the color photos as well.
Popping out within minutes of the event in that
exactly,
sense. Wire photo and all that.
And then, I mean, there was a wire photos trend started. Yeah.
So Sandeep, tell us about your shifting to Dubai. How did it come about? So Bikram went there, he got a job there, and he pulled 5-6 of you all from here.
Correct. I told Ravi Shankar, Louis, Gabriel, and all who used to work for Navin Times, he offered us a job. And if you recollect Patrick Michael. Goan guy from, he used to work in midday. So he gave him a job offer also. They were relaunching this Gulf News in a new avatar, so to speak. So that is where there were a scope for a lot of recruitment. And he chose all of us and took us there. I basically went there thinking, you know, that I would be there for a couple of years to buy a good camera gear and then come back. Because those days, you know, having a good camera meant a lot and it costed a lot. So I thought, okay, but Dubai is such a place that, you know, it kind of grows on you. And I lived there for almost 30, 35 years. And then now I'm back in Goa.
But hats off to you. I mean, at least you thought of coming back and could make the return, although you have one foot in Goa, one foot in Australia.
Yeah, always been a Goan-centric.
Sarke. So to shift a bit of gears, if we could just move to the other photos of the time. Just a second. Let me see.
You can display them and
okay.
I can.
Okay. Speak. Yeah. So this is one of your Gulf photos, right? Sorry.
Can I?
Just give me a sec. I'll just need to.
Yeah, sure.
Share. This kind of becomes a bit tricky because you never know what you're sharing and what you're watching. But anyway,
are you displaying that?
Oh, just a sec. No, not yet.
Okay.
But you can carry on, Sandeep, while I get the picture in action.
Yeah.
you were telling us about this photos in Dubai and your work in Dubai. One of your famous photos from there is Wind Chadda.
If you display this, I will probably.
If you can just see the pictures of Wind Chadda and he's getting into a lift or getting out of a lift. I will display it eventually, but I have to struggle a little to getting my technology.
It was during that Bofors thing.
Right.
And every media was trying to work, find out where he was. And at that point of time, somebody tipped us that he was staying at Galleria, which is the Hyatt Regency residency. And this is one of my paparazzi moments. I had never done something like this, and to stalk someone and to, you know, follow him. And it just happened that he entered the foyer and the guard told me, "This is Saab aaye hain." And I just went in, and luckily for me, he had entered the elevator. Yeah. And when I was taking the photo, the elevator closed and he was like screaming his head off. And he said, "Who is this guy? Who is this? I want security. Kidhar hai? Kya hai?" Thankfully, the door closed and the lift went up. And then, you know, rest is the history.
So you actually managed to catch him unaware and couldn't do anything to you at the same time.
He couldn't do anything. Then he called up the office. He was screaming, "Who's this?" and all that. But I mean, we published this image.
I see. What are the other photos you remember from that period?
The other photos from that period mostly were, I one shouldn't say fortunate, but I was, you know, in my field, I will say that covering a war is, I know how it's a morbid thought, but at the same time, one has to look at it professionally. So I was fortunate to, you know, to see the sorties of F-16 going, being on the battleships. Yeah, you got it. You got that.
Yeah.
So, going on to the battleships, you know, and seeing media refueling. And I think that whole experience of Gulf War. And prior to that, the Iran-Iraq War, we used to see a lot of ships being attacked by the sea mines. Yeah, you can see these images. These are the times at the Gulf War.
I see.
Yeah.
It says somewhere in the Gulf, U.S.
Yeah, that's why, because you couldn't identify the place.
Yeah, identify.
By the way, this is the time I used to string for AFP, the Agence France-Presse.
Yeah.
Yeah,
which is the largest news agency in the world.
And they were yeah. So I was again very fortunate to work for them, and I used to file my pictures in Paris, and they, at that time they had an office in Bahrain, but now they have a full scale presence in Dubai.
So now at this point of time, sharing the photos and all has become not difficult. You are using photo faxes, or how are you sending your pictures?
This particular time, there was a transmitter given to me, and it was a drum transmitter. You had to, you know, send three color images and then black and white. It used to take a lot of time. It was not digital. It was an analog sending.
So it's a drum, and you put your photo onto the
photo
drum, and then it scans, line by line.
Exactly. Then
color by
bar.
color
yeah,
by color,
exactly,
and then back
exactly,
also. My
exactly,
goodness. And that
exactly.
is being sent by phone lines, which are very
phone lines. Too. Yes, yes. And that was sent directly to Paris. Yeah. And then the Paris would send it. Yeah. That was
very,
a very laborious process at that point of time.
But it was still a step ahead, and we thought it was
much ahead. Yeah,
I remember ahead. When people came with this for the Chogham Commonwealth retreat in Goa, and we thought, wow, so advanced, you can send photos across the world in seconds.
Exactly.
And today, like, you're sitting in Ribandar, and I'm sitting at Saligaon, and it's like you're in the same
now room. Now I mean that's what technology has taken leaps and bounds, you know. Now I mean I remember again I went into freelance work. I had fortunate again to have Emirates Airlines as my client, and I was official photographer for them. I remember when the Sheikh Ahmed made his annual speech, I must have taken the picture, and within 90 seconds or so, I had to upload it, and it was worldwide.
I see.
Yeah. I mean, these are again battleships. Okay. And they were all French, American, all allied forces. And this was a very good experience to go there on the ships and do this.
So at this time, video has not yet come into its own, and
no.
Transmitting a photograph is also a challenge.
Yeah, and even mobile phones were not there at that point of time.
Correct.
So
we are talking about still.
Yeah, these are all analog photography.
Yeah, all analog. What cameras are you using then?
I was using Nikon F3, which was like the very good camera
advanced
at that point of time.
Yeah.
Very advanced camera. I mean,
very costly.
Yeah, yeah. Gulf News had given me the gear.
Yeah.
So it was company's thing. And then I think much later in 91-92, I think we went, this is the sorties of F-16, and they you know, it was really a pleasure to see them take off.
Where, in Dubai?
No, this was in, now I can reveal the place, it was in Al Ain at the airbase.
I see.
Yeah,
I
those see. Days we couldn't identify where the place was.
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct.
This is a very, very in the deep in the desert. These are very Arab Bedouin, you call them, and yeah. They don't basically come out. I was again lucky that, you know, the gentleman who was with me, he allowed me to photograph. She's a part of his family. Otherwise, they are very, very shy, and they just don't like taking photos.
Interesting. And this?
This is a story actually done for the Weekend, that is the Khalees Times magazine, after I had left Gulf News. So this gentleman, they say they cannot date back his age. I mean, he was saying as he went back, he would be over 100 years. And he lives in this fort. It's a ruins in Fujairah. And he has survived this many years just by being, and he doesn't even get out. He just comes, and they call him a man in the fort.
I see.
Yeah.
So
it was, yeah.
Sorry, so carry on.
No, it was basically a story based on him.
Human interest.
Human interest story of the Khalees Times, yeah.
If you had to compare work in Goa and the Gulf, apart from the resources there, how would you compare it and how would you contrast it?
The time when I went there, Dubai was not as open as it is now. You know, there were so many restrictions. You had to take a lot of permissions from the government authorities, and the media was far, far more controlled at that point of time. And these were challenges that you had to go through. This is a thing in Oman. It's a sort of oasis there, and it's a World Heritage site. So
now we are coming to the 90s or 2000s, because it's obviously color and modern and...
Yeah, yeah. This is digital. These images are all digital. These were taken, I think, few years back.
You shifted to digital, and how did you feel about the change?
I think initially, again, like I am from the old school. So for me, you know, digital was good because it was showing instant results, and it was very convenient to reproduce the images. But I still feel that even if you are doing digital, you need to go and get your basics there.
to digital, understand.
In digital, what is the advantage? When we were shooting analog, our photo editor used to say, in one roll, mere ko do assignment chahiye, teen assignment chahiye. Now, even if you take 1,000 images, people still say, "Arey, itna hi shoot kiya," and you can shoot 10,000 images, you will bound to get 10 images good.
So what you're saying is that when you were doing it on a roll, you were forced to be more economic with your use of films.
Exactly, more economic,
more careful,
and far more careful in what your settings were. You had to be very sure. Especially if you're shooting transparencies, because transparencies were very expensive. In fact, the client himself used to say, "Are you please get me just two shots and this thing," because it increased their expenditure on raw material.
Right.
But in digital today, you can shoot hundreds and thousands of images.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not fair to say, but I think this somewhere down the line with the Photoshop and the, I know the younger generation will not like it, what I'm saying, but I guess somewhere the skill is not that important right now, or is so essential.
So sorry for the distraction. I'm just struggling a bit with the mm-hmm. screen sharing again. But you know, you have some lovely photos here of Dubai and of the Gulf and modern city lights. And what are the main themes in your work that have excited you? Of course, your main photo was the student lathi charge thing. But what are the other themes that really excite you and that make you feel like?
I mean, when I was working with Emirates, I had a lot of assignments to cover sports, and especially since you asked me what was the difference between the working in Goa and when you went to Dubai. In Goa, you only knew about football and cricket, but when you went to Dubai, you came to know there was a sport called bowling, there was a sport called rugby, there was a squash, and you know, other disciplines that you had never heard of, and to get to know them. Golf is a very tricky sport to cover, unless and until you, and Elric will vouch for that. He and I have covered many golf events. So has Willy, and they will tell you that there are such intricacies in covering that sport. But once you understand the game, then it's very interesting to cover that. And my good fortune, as I say, I keep repeating that good fortune, because these are the opportunities that you need to get. You could be very good with your work, but if you don't get opportunities or you don't create those opportunities, then it's not worth it. You know,
you've shot a lot of fashion and also city life.
Yes, I have, because that's the time I was to work with. Gulf News has a lifestyle magazine called Friday. And they cover a lot of fashions, and I've covered food. See, that's what I mean. When you go to Dubai, you have to be multi-dimensional. You can't be saying, "I will only cover news. I will be only hardcore news guy." You have to get yourself, used to covering various fields, like, as I said, cookery, sports, or fashion, or day-to-day life. I think the beauty about photography is that you have to be ready to cover everything, from, as I said, it's somebody's funeral to somebody's felicitation to celebration to any aspect. When you are asked to cover, you have to cover them. If you remember the downing of the Iranian airliner by the US, I think it was Wisconsin or something, they had brought down the Iranian plane. I met this gentleman from Iran, whose 19 members of his family had traveled on that, because they were attending a wedding in Iran.
I see.
And to see this guy was such a heart-wrenching thing, but you had to take his photo, you had to, you know, show the, and that picture also, I don't have it here, it's in the Gulf News archives, that got published even internationally. It was just that this man was sitting with his head and crying.
That's a very tough part
exactly, of the life. That is so precisely
what I'm
between,
saying. You are caught between your sense of humanness and humanity and your duty to your job. And
yeah.
You have to tell the story.
You have to tell the story. And another aspect about it, if you remember the famous sixer hit by Javed Miandad of Chetan Sharma, that was one of my first assignment to cover in cricket. Okay. And I took that picture and I was totally, you know, distraught by how we lost that game. And, you know,
You were distraught because you lost the game and you were thrilled with your photo, huh? The mixed feelings.
No. Listen to this.
Okay. Sorry.
So I was totally distraught and I showed, apparently my displeasure was very evident, and my boss, Mr. Hassan Bozai, he was a Pakistani guy. He was a photo editor of Dawn newspaper and very elderly gentleman. He just tapped me on the shoulder and he said, "Sandeep, now remember, you are an international photographer. You are not an Indian photographer. You have to be, you know, we all have emotions, but you have to keep your emotions at bay, because you cannot be, you know, showing your bias or whatever this side to you." And it taught me a great lesson at that point of time, that however you may be feeling, you're feeling that you said that your country is losing, but at that point of time, you are just a photographer, not an Indian photographer or a cricket-loving photographer or whatever it is. You're just documenting things, and that dispassionately.
Sandeep, tell us your Sachin Tendulkar story.
Oh, yeah. Okay. This was when Sachin had come for the first time to Sharjah. And everybody was fascinated with him at that point of time after his thing. He was just 17 and it was his 17th birthday. And that was being celebrated in a hotel in Sharjah. And I had a friend called Prakash Lulla, who used to own the Astoria Hotel. And he just gave me a call and he says, "Sandeep, let's go and meet Tendulkar at his hotel," because the Ali Irani was a physiotherapist, a physio guy at that time of the team. And he had arranged this meeting. So me and Prakash went there, and this picture, I have not displayed it and I don't want to show it because it's almost a world exclusive. He's sitting like this with folded hands and curly hair and just shorts and the cake in front of him. And this, you know, like a typical 17-year-old kid whose birthday is being celebrated by someone. So he was very happy. And then Prakash asked him, he said, "Sachin, what gift should I give you? You know, I have not brought a gift for you." So he said, "You know, I like a Walkman." And I remember
it was a big thing in those days. Walkmans were big thing.
And there's this store in Dubai called Jumbo's, which used to still have the agency for Sony. So he called up his office staff and they asked him to buy the best of the Walkman, and they brought it, and we were there in his room. He was so taken up by this thing, he, you know, ripped open the thing, and Prakash asked him, he says, "Do you want me to buy you any music CDs? Sorry, cassettes." So he says, "No, I want to listen to yoga tapes." And that's where, you know, Frederick, I was wondering, I said, this guy is cut out of different fabric, you know, he's a different guy altogether. At 17, he knew that he had to listen to yoga tapes to calm himself down and all that. And no wonder you see him where he is today.
A question or two from our listeners. Kitter Faya, who's been a journalist and into PR. What's your earliest childhood memory, if any, related to photography?
Childhood memory is I was always fascinated by visual medium, and I at that point of time, you know, owning a camera was a big deal. That I did not have the camera, but when I went to art college, yes, I knew that this is a place for me, and this is what I want to do, and thankfully I chose that. But yes, Kitter always had the thing. I think for me, I'm more of a visual guy. I don't remember the dates and times and all that thing. But anything that is pictorial always fascinates me.
So you had any role models who you admired and you wanted to follow in photography, either in college, college or whenever?
I think Raghu Rai was our, I mean, he was a, that hero. Time everybody wanted to follow Raghu Rai, and I mean, he was my hero at that point of time, no doubt about it. And I think he changed the face of photojournalism. His displays, I mean, you know what I really admired about him is his sense of composition. And one of his quote I saw, that he says, half of the work I do is on the easel. He's framing.
Imagining the photo, how it would look.
No, he says, I take the picture, when I put it on the easel during the black and white days, you kind of crop it. And balance the image how you want it. That is a big aspect of photography.
That was for Illustrated Weekly and all that he did.
I think he was with India Today also.
India Today also.
That is where his most memorable pictures were.
It is a coincidence that the magazines also grew at around our time. No, whether it was India Today, Illustrated
that
Weekly,
is right.
And the Pritish Nandi and Kushwant Singh earlier. So printing technology also, a lot of happy coincidences happened in those years.
In fact, I had done a couple of assignments for our famous Claude Alvarez. He used to write for Illustrated Weekly. And I had done a couple of photos for him.
Of what?
One of them was, I remember, the pollution of Zuwaari.
I see.
Yeah, and then there was one more. I think we did a story on coastal zones or something like that. I went to Dubai. After that, I haven't.
Sandeep, Alaric is asking, Alaric Gomes,
yes.
Journalist colleague from Goa.
Hi, Alaric.
My colleague and your colleague,
yes.
Later. Sandy, how much do you actually miss the thrill today?
Yes, I do. And especially Dubai, is an amazing place. And the kind of work Alaric and I did there was something to, I can't forget, and I'll never ever forget. Dubai teaches you a lot. And because it's like a United Nations of expats, You find so many nationalities, so many languages, so many cultures that you learn from all of those. And then it's such a buzzing place. There's some big event or the other. For example, I was with Emirates again, one of the best airline of the world. And they never stopped at anything that is, mediocre or something. They were always striving to be the best. And Dubai has that in it, to be the best. When I went to Dubai, Dubai was just a one horse town. But look at what it is today. And thanks to the visionary, ruler and the people of Dubai, I do miss that, yes. But as I said, being in Goa, I don't... I miss my colleagues and work, but I'm far more happier here in Goa.
So which was your best assignment ever? And Ashley is asking a related question on, Ashley DeMello, X Times of India, is asking whether you had to hold back any photos because of politics.
I meaning
no kiss and tell maybe yes or no. I mean, like,
there have been instances because of obvious media restrictions, and it was not on me. It is it was decided by their editorial team.
It's a tough call.
It is a tough call.
Like telling, but we have to survive to fight another, to live another day, and to.
But I must tell Ashley, now it has grown leaps and bounds. And today, what you can write and you can publish in Dubai, which was unthinkable or unheard of. And Dubai is something that I guess where every journalist keep pushing the boundary.
So another
you're reprimanded.
Another comment from Ashley, who says that Raghu Rai was with the Statesman for some years.
He was with Statesman, and I think he was with India Today as well, because I distinctly remember his thing.
If you have to look back at your stints, this guy, if you had to look back at your stints, what would be the one you like the most, or you look back to with nostalgia the most, or you would like to go back to, if you had another chance, another lifetime, like all of us?
I think my thing would be covering sports. Yeah. I enjoyed covering sports, but at the same time, again, very fortunate to, you know, the photography is a good medium to meet people. You may meet a pauper or a millionaire or a celebrity, and everyone has a story to tell and a story to. So in photography, that every day was a different thing. It was never a desk job or a monotonous one. So I enjoyed every aspect of it.
You woke up every day just looking forward to that day, because it was such a new day and different from everything else.
Yeah, exactly. Different. You covered different genres, basically. You know, you were somewhere covering. Okay, there is not much of a politics per se in Dubai, but other aspects are a lot. You know, you're covering people-oriented stories time and again. And that is what fascinates me.
Yeah. I'm still really trying to get in some of our pictures, because they are lovely pictures here. And I'm unfortunately struggling a bit with the technology.
Yeah, but, no issues.
But just give me a sec, and if we can get in.
If you know, I had taken a sabbatical for a year. And if you remember, we both were at that point of time to do a coffee table book. So most of my stuff that I have in Fred, this is at the camel race, and those days the kids were used as the jockeys.
If you see the
kids being mounted on the camel, what had happened was a lot of these human rights activists and the child welfare associations and all had a major issue. And finally, now they use a robotic. They place a robot on top of the camel and they run. But this particular image I took, because this is something, and these are the handlers of the camel. And before 1, 2, 3, you know, they just jump. So I kind of stayed down, and I won a Minolta photojournalism award for this picture.
You're at a very low level. You're at the ground level.
Absolutely. And this F3 had this a feature where you could take the viewing mirror up. You know, you could.
I see.
Yeah, and then place it down below, and then take that picture at a wide angle.
I see. Interesting. This is Vinchadda.
This is the one I was telling you. And thankfully, at the nth minute, the elevator closed. And then we had to run from there. And that's
otherwise
why you
he would have been running after you. He would have been
You would have strangled me for all. Because he's quite a big unit, you know. He's a large guy, tall.
And you were a small unit in those days.
I was like, absolutely. Yeah, right. Yeah.
Interesting.
This was I did as a PR thing for a Coke, and this won the award for the internal Coke thing. There were
lovely,
two
lovely
in...
contrast, lovely contrast, and very simple, but standing out.
This was post my Gulf News when I went as a freelancer. Yeah.
Okay. This, of course, we saw.
These are ones, yeah.
Yeah.
These are the ISR missiles, and this is the F-16s at that those days.
The lady.
This is the old lady at the desert.
Then,
again, we've spoken about this.
Yeah, this we've seen.
These are again Oman thing. This is called Wadi. And they have this water, in the midst of the desert.
I see.
You have to do a lot of rock. This was when the Burj Arab had inaugurated. Yeah.
Which year?
I don't remember.
Lovely picture. Just see the lights. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Same.
These are all those same time that during the inaugural. This was taken in Safa Park. This is a very kind of a mood shot.
I see.
This is the kid playing in the water in the Jumeirah.
Lovely image.
Thanks. Again, yeah. I think you're going back. This is the silhouette of Burj. Yeah.
Lovely colors. Digital.
This is digital, yes. This is digital.
Wow.
This is again, yeah. This is again fashion I had done for Emirates. This is for I had my client Mac.
I see.
The cosmetic, yeah.
To shoot close-ups at such close range and to shoot food is probably the toughest. What's the toughest?
With food you got to be a careful that you know how your lighting is, how, because if you overexpose the food it may not look very appetizing, and if you underexpose also it may look a little late. So you have to be careful about how you deal with the light at the food, and close-ups is the best to.
This is
again a fashion which is a short. And this is the shot was in Goa. I had done for my nephew's wife is a fashion designer, so I shot this for her. Yeah. This is again with Emirates. These are all cabin crew who are posing, and are models. Yeah, these are models. This is a normal fashion show. I think it was. Caravan Herrera or someone, I think.
I see.
Again, one of the French designers. This is Anushka Shankar.
Okay. Ravi Shankar's daughter.
Ravi Shankar's daughter. I did cover a lot of concerts also.
I see.
This is John Legend.
I see.
He had come for the jazz festival. This is, I think, the band Train. And these are all the concerts, basically, that I've covered.
That's a lifetime of images.
Yeah, this is the, I think, I don't remember the name of the singer. She's at a very famous song. Sorry.
It will come.
Yeah.
A hard disk are clogged by now with so many memories.
Yeah.
So many memories and so many more images.
This is one of the, again, concert with the...
I see.
This is the when Emirates signed the deal with Real Madrid. He's the CEO of Real Madrid, and here the Mr. Tim Clark is the CEO of Emirates.
Interesting.
This is very interesting. I did not know that I was to take the picture of Bill Gates, because it was such a kind of a kept a secret. Even the PR manager just said, Sandeep, you have to be at this place at this time. And I very casually as a thing went there, and suddenly I saw there's a lot of, police presence and high dignitaries and all that. And then I came to know that Bill Gates was supposed to come to sign the deal with the Emirates.
I see.
And then I was asked to speak to Bill Gates' team, his security team, and plus I think they said, you will have only 1 minute with Mr. Gates. You are not to ask him anything. You are not to ask him, So I think there will be no dialogue or a conversation between you and him and all that. So I was like, this is like, and this again, I was
take it or leave it.
Yeah, and I was the only photographer. There was no media, no nothing. This was a private thing. So, and I knew this is like, again, when you have so much of pressure on you, or that you have to deliver. If you don't deliver, you're gone.
And if you make a mistake also, you're gone. I mean, no one.
Exactly. Exactly. At that point of time, you are hoping and praying everything. See, you can be sure about your skills. You can be dead sure about, your abilities.
But anything can go wrong.
Because end of the day, it's a machine.
Yeah.
End of the day, it's a machine. It can just die down on you, or something can happen. So I just, again, thankfully, he was in a Sheikh Ahmed, who is on to the right of the frame. Obviously, because I used to interact with him all the time. So he asked me, I said, Your Highness, can we have a handshake? And because they were not planning to have a handshake. So then he smiled, and that's when again, very widely published picture.
I see. Very interesting.
This is the Sheikh Mohammed, the ruler of Dubai, with the airport in the background when he visited the Emirates headquarters. This is the CEO of Tim Clark of Emirates. This is one of the portrait I did. This again, when Emirates signed a deal with Formula One.
I see.
Yeah. This is Becker and Djokovic. And this is at one of the football events he had come to watch. I think it was.
You would prefer, Sandeep, you would prefer pictures which are out of the usual, not the protocol ones, obviously.
Yeah, I mean, that is what every photographer, thrives to do.
So we are, I think we've done the full circle. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
So, one last question.
Yeah, sure.
From here, where? What are your plans with all this treasure of images? How do you?
No, as I said, when I was talking to you, I am in the process of getting a lot of my stuff digitized, because that is how the future is and all that. So, getting into a scanning lot of my images, transparencies and all that. I'm not trying to say boast or something. I have some very, very good images about Goa, which was taken 20 plus years back. And so, for example, I told you the other day that I have an image with this fisher guy, Mustaka Ramje, Kashti Marun in Arambol beach.
Yeah.
And then today, when you go to Arambol, you can't even recognize Arambol.
Yeah.
So those kind of very, I would call them a treasure of mine.
They are an absolute treasure, Sandeep. Keep them, make the most use of them. I wish you all the best. And
thank
this is,
you.
Of course, you're still young. You have another 40 years to go at least. No, I'm not laughing.
I like to think I'm young, yeah.
No. I mean, it's all in the mind. Thank you so much for all the work you've done.
Pleasure. Really always a pleasure.
Really,
and I hope it wasn't boring.
No, it was very interesting. And I'm sure this documentation will stay up on YouTube for a long time to come. I hope YouTube remains there. Thanks so much. After we are
thank
all
you.
Gone. And we
thank
pass.
You. Appreciate it.
All
thanks
best.
For
all
having
me.